So the Slovaks, just who were always through their history have been part of the Hungarian state up to the 20th century, just like the Romanians, were historically, well, most of the Romanians will be peasants, and Slovaks especially, most of them will be peasants. So there will be this historical memory or identity of, oh, we have been the peasants oppressed by the Hungarian nobles. Well, it wasn't completely accurate because there were Romanian nobles and so on. There were many Hungarian peasants, right? A good number, but it was clear that, I mean, there is a factual element to the fact that, you know, in Transylvania, for example, most of the nobles were probably Hungarian speakers and, you know, German speakers and so on. Most, right? Most. But it didn't mean that they really didn't have Hungarian peasants and so on. So there's this history of, you know, oppression, perceived or real, you know, social cleavages, social differences that overlapped with ethnic differences, ethnic cleavages. Okay, that about Transylvania, as I said, one of the most flourishing culturally, politically, and free from Ottoman occupation. Actually, very powerful at that point, but interesting enough. Now, in the Habsburg part of the what was before Hungarian state, what was the situation? As I said, the nobles there kept their diets or kept their the right to be and represent the Hungarian nation, well, at least in those lands, and they gave the crown to the Habsburg ruler, right? Well, not that they had a different choice, but they gave the crown, which means that the Habsburg ruler, whoever it was at that point after the Philip, Battle of Mohács, ruled sort of indirectly these lands. So it wasn't a direct control, unlike the Czech lands. Now remember that we talked about the fact that the Czech lands, Bohemia, right? The Habsburg was the ruler of those lands directly. And that's very important, because as I said, during the Enlightenment, when you have these absolute monarchs, these enlightened monarchs, trying to impose their reforms in these lands, in the Czechs, and their control, right? Because being able to implement the policy means that you're also able to have the power to impose those policies. Well, in the Czech lands, they will be able to do that and to impose Austrian, Vienna-based control of the lands. Not here. So you're going to say, well, this is nice. This is nice. So they maintain their independence. And it's true. Now, it took some fighting, right? There were uprisings against Habsburg rule, very powerful, the famous Rákóczi insurrection at the end of the 18th century with support from the French who opposed the Habsburgs, but also from the Turks, interestingly enough, wanted to undermine the Habsburgs. But anyway, you have these these uprisings, right? So that also teaches the Habsburgs that you can't just, you know, deal lightly with these nasty Hungarians. A key moment, you know, as I said, about from between 1526 and for 160 years, the Hungary will be divided, you know, as I just explained. This will last until 1699, when the Treaty of Karlowitz, you know, remember, this is after the Battle of Vienna, where the Polish king, you know, led the armies that defeated the Ottomans. That's 1683. 1699, they signed the key Treaty of Karlowitz, when all of Hungary regains its independence again. So let's go to 1700, there it is. But where is Hungary, right? It is part of the Habsburg Empire. So the Hungary gets rid of the Ottoman rule, but it becomes part of the Habsburg Empire, which it spreads tremendously towards the east. Let's go to 1750, right? And this is a good moment to look at. So there it is. So you see, it's Austria. It's not Austria, there is no Austria. It's the Habsburg Empire, which is a multinational empire, which controlled these Hungarian lands, right? So but it was obviously a different sort of a control. Both because there were uprisings by nobles and so on, but also because Hungary maintained its parliament that represented the nobles and the clergy. And as I said, the Habsburgs did. So these lands were part of an empire, but they were part with their own diet. Remember how the Croatian lands used to be part of the Hungarian state, but with their own parliament and own diet. But the same sort of here, and again, it took some fighting to clarify what is the situation. But the point is that when you have these enlightened monarchs like Maria Theresa and Joseph I, who implemented these forceful reforms, as in many other places in the world, you know, they, and also direct control over the, over different lands, they will not be able to exercise, to impose this control over the Hungarian part of their empire, because of this mediation by, because the political nation, which was the nobles, maintained their you know, authority. And you're going to say, oh, that's nice, you know, freedom, blah, 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 right? Well, perhaps, right, the Czechs became part of direct control. But what's the downside? The downside is that, what was the situation in these Hungarian lands? The peasants were, their situation was very bad. There was a nation of nobles, many, many petty nobles, meaning many, many small nobles, which were perhaps poor, but had these political, civil, you know, privileges and rights, right? In fact, so many petty nobles that, you know, this increased this, this feeling that, you know, Hungarians were seeing themselves as a nation of nobles with privileges. I mean, it's, you know, you might not have a cent in your pocket, but you're, you know, you have these special privileges, you have, you are, you have these rights. And this is also kind of similarity between Polish and Hungarian history. Both have been historically a nation of nobles. Not that, it didn't mean that everybody was a noble, it just meant that the nobles were the nation, right? And when more and more nobles were created, right, more and more people became part of it, right? But the relationship within the society remained feudal, remained agricultural. This is the end of the 17th century, so, and these lands do not become part of the Industrial Revolution because most of the economy will remain agricultural. Most of the economy will be, and wealth will be based on huge landholdings. And there were a few huge landholders, and many, so which were the big nobles, and many small nobles who had just small, you know, properties or not even that much, right? And so, and remember that the reforms that the Habsburg emperors and all these enlightened emperors tried to implement were reforms that tried to change the society from feudal societies into more egalitarian, more, you know, changing feudalism from feudalism to more modern relationships, and so on. Now, they could do that in the Czech lands, because they have direct control and Czechs have little to say, but they couldn't do it in the Hungarian lands, which maintained their proud independence, which meant that they were also more backward. So here's the two sides. The two sides of policy making, that you want to have efficient policy, you give a lot of power to the government, okay? And which means that you don't have less, fewer rights in a way, right? So that's the conundrum. So anyway, that's where we are at 1800. These lands, the Hungarian lands, are part of the Austrian, of the Habsburg Empire, but they have their own rule. It's feudal, it's kind of backward, and that's basically where we are in the 1800. Good. So in the second lecture on this period, we will cover the Danubian principalities, Transylvania, Wallachia, Moldova, Bosnia, and some words about Serbian and Bulgaria, Serbians and Bulgarians under the Ottoman Empire.